guide me. You know, this is something you want to look forward to. You want that information to come from where? From the Holy Spirit. God has made promises. You have to claim those promises, or quite frankly, you're out. So naturally, you want to ask for guidance. And when you ask, he's going to give it. Why? It's one of his promises. So in these end times especially, when you connect yourself with Mark 13, where you know the Spirit wants to speak through you, when you're delivered up before the dragon, the Antichrist, Satan, the serpent, by whatever name he wishes to go by, the Holy Spirit's going to speak through you. It's not going to be an unknown tongue. It's going to be heard in every language of the world. So open your Bibles, if you would, to Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. We're going to pick it up and begin with verse 26. The subject being, guide me. Verse 26, and it reads, and the angel of the Lord, which means the very presence of God, spake unto Philip, saying, arise and go toward the south unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And this is the same Gaza where there is much trouble even to this day. Philip means a lover of horses. Okay. Verse 27. Understand, this is a direct command from God. Why? Because Philip was a servant of God. Verse 27. And he arose and went naturally. And behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch, of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship. He loved God. Maybe he didn't have a clear understanding of everything, but he did love God and he wished to follow God. So, enough that he made a trip all the way from Ethiopia to Jerusalem in a buggy to worship. Verse 28, he was returning and sitting in his chariot. He read Esaias, which is to say Isaiah, the prophet. He's sitting there reading it. 29, and the Spirit, now what Spirit would that be? Well, it's the Holy Spirit, of course, God's Spirit. The angel of God, the one that sent him there. Naturally, the Holy Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. In other words, God is guiding him to accomplish what it is God would have him accomplish. This is an example to you in these end times when you need guidance. Well, I just don't know which way to turn. Well, don't be stupid. Ask him. Okay? Think. Consider. Think about it. And is he going to just come right out and say, well, no, he's written you a letter. He's pretty well laid out what it is you're supposed to do. Have you ever read it? That's the problem. Verse 30, and Philip ran thither to him. He didn't hesitate. And he heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and he said, understandest thou what thou readest? You understand that? 31, and he said, how can I, except some man should guide me? Now, guide me is the subject we're after today. And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. Now, let me ask you a question. Here, Philip. Philip's going to guide him. And a lot of people would say, oh, yes, Philip's going to do it. Really? Is that as deep as you can think? Who told Philip to go there? God did. Who's going to tell Philip what to say? Well, God has over a period of time. God does the guiding. Okay. Though man may try to take credit for it sometimes, it is God himself through the Holy Spirit. If you believe and if you ask, that will give you guidance. Intuitively, when a door opens, you'll know it. Intuitively, when a door closes, you will know it. Period. Unction from who? The Holy Spirit, of course. guide me. That's a promise of God. Claim it. Okay, well, this and God intends to use this one Philip to accomplish that. Now, verse 32. The place of the scripture which he read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shears, so opened he not his mouth. And of course, he's reading Isaiah chapter 53. It's the witness of Christ when he was delivered up to be crucified. 33, in his humiliation, his humbleness, his judgment was taken away, and who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. Well, if Christ is crucified and he's taken away, who is going to claim his generation, his truth, here on earth? You are. He guiding, you following, and it's a blessing to everyone when the truth comes forth. Verse 34, and the eunuch answered Philip, and he said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this? Of himself or of some other man? He didn't know. That's why God is showing you people need guides, but they need to be able to follow instruction from the Holy Spirit, especially in these end times. You lock in and understand. 35, then Philip opened his mouth and he began at the same scripture and he preached unto him Jesus. He said, this one that came, as verse 1 declares, from the root of Jesse, and came forth, and there was David, and out of David came this one who lacked nothing in beauty. He had everything. It was the Son of God. It was the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he was led up before Pontius Pilate, he didn't whimper or cry or think, I wonder if we could put this off till tomorrow. You know, I'm a little worried about it. No. He held his ground and he fulfilled prophecy exactly as it's written, because you see, the Holy Spirit is the voice of Christ and God, Emmanuel, God with us, being the Savior. And so the eunuch's going to understand this because he's got an excellent teacher in this one Philip. Verse 36. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? Boy, he picked it up quick, didn't he? And he understood. You can actually, between Gaza and the city Ashdod and Caesarea, you can find this little stream, because there's not much water out in the desert, even to this day. And pretty well know where this baptism took place. Verse 37, and Philip said, if thou believest, there's that big if. You know, a lot. Do you qualify for that? You see, we're talking about guiding me. That's yourself. What are the qualifications? If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest, and he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That's what is necessary. I believe he was able. That's what it's insinuating. 38, and he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. Verse 39, and when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. This doesn't mean he raptured, as some might teach, but the Holy Spirit had other purposes for him. You can read in Acts chapter 21, verse 9, that this Philip had four virgin daughters, and they were all preachers, like it or lump it. You know, they were all prophets. You might say, well, a man probably, they were virgins. The only man that taught them was Philip and the Holy Spirit. And they were excellent teachers, excellent prophetists, and brought that message forth. Do you know something else? The land in which they prophesied was originally from assigned to the tribe of Judah. But Judah never conquered it. But Philip and those four virgins did. They converted people from Gaza all the way up to Caesarea, in a land that no army ever took. The power of the Holy Spirit did. And he used one man and four girls. That's one and four, to get it done, okay? But can we give them credit for it? Well, you want to think for a moment. No. The Holy Spirit touched them, led them, guided them. That's why you want to pray for guidance, that he touch you and give you that knowledge. Well, I just kind of like to make up my own mind. Well, there's a ditch, fall in it, okay? That's probably where you'll end up at. It doesn't hurt to consult with our Father. You know, you can pay $150 an hour for counseling in this world, or you can read this letter of the High Counselor. You can't buy this from Almighty God through the Holy Spirit to lead and direct you and to have that. You know, this is proof that those Christians that were converted from Gaza all the way up still remain to this day, that truth. And so it is that an army of Israel never took it, but the word of God did, to the point that that truth still remains. Verse 40 to complete. But Philip was found at Azotus. That's Ashdod to you, okay? And passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea, or Caesarea, as some say in English. Okay, so there you have it. He preached all up and down from Gaza, the strip, all the way up through, and so it was. Let's go now back to John chapter 14. What about this promise? What is it that you should seek? Jesus had already said in this 14th chapter, I'm going to go away. I'm going to my Father's house, and in my Father's house are many mansions, but the word in the Greek is mono. It means resting place. Do you have a resting place today, or are you all worked up? You see, there's only one resting place, not some big house. It's the presence of the Holy Spirit touching you, guiding you, whereby you know you're on safe ground, whereby you know that you're being led of God. His promise always comes through as it is written. You can be successful. You can prosper if you do it God's way. That's what people want, is results. And you do get them. But where did this promise come from? Well, you'll find in part right here in John chapter 14. Let's pick it up, if we may, with verse 21. It's a beautiful chapter. We want a different subject for a different time, but I want the promise is what I want. Verse 21 of chapter 14, the great book of St. John. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, that's kind of a condition, isn't it? He it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. I will make myself present with him. That's what manifestation is. I will speak with him. I will lead him. I will guide him. Well, how is he going to do that? Well, let's find out. Verse 22. Judas saith unto him, not Iscariot now, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us and not unto the world? How in the world is he going to do that? Number one, first you have to meet those conditions. You have to know his commandments pretty well, and you have to obey them as best you can, and you have to love him. And if you do, he's going to tell you how it's done, okay? Verse 23, Jesus answered and said unto him, if, there's that big old word again, if a man love me, he will keep my words. That's this letter. And my Father will love him, And we, that's both, Father and Son, will come unto him and make our abode with him. Do you know what this word abode is in the Hebrew, the Greek? It's mano, it means mansion. We're going to live with you. We're going to give you a resting place. That's what Sabbath means in the Hebrew tongue, resting place. Gives you rest. You're never, ever, ever going to have peace of mind totally until you absorb the promise of God and the guidance of God into giving you that rest, which is solid assurance that his word comes to pass as it's written. You can count on it. But the ifs are important. God doesn't like doubters. And I'm going to tell you something. Well, you don't understand. The reason I doubt, I've got a little bit of faith. No, you don't have any faith. In my book, there's no such thing as a little faith. You either have it or you don't. Period. End of story. It's so easy to believe, if you study the letter he sent you, to know the crucifixion was spoken of in Psalms 22, 1,000 years, even down to what the Roman soldiers would be doing. Man can't arrange that. God can. Why? To document to you, to give you a testimony whereby you can believe. And then in believing, the true believer, when you see God's promises coming to pass in your own life, then you know of a certainty, I believe, and believe you do. That is the rest. That is the peace of mind that you acquire within that. That's the way he guides you, intuitively and with unction, spiritually for you to know in spiritual discernment, right from left and right from wrong and up from down, straight on. Keep the course, hold the plumb bob, and watch what you're doing. Okay, verse 24. He that loveth me and keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me, 25, these things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. In other words, I've shared this with you. How am I going to continue it? How can I guide you in the future if I'm not here? 26, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send, did he say maybe? No, will send in my name. You have to claim it in the name of Christ. He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. This word teach is didasko, and so it is. It's a sister word to guide. That is instruction. How to get it done. What was it again now that the Holy Spirit was going to do? Teach. Teach what? Teach all things and bring things to your remembrance. You know, the reason God's elect, finally when the light turns on and they see a truth and it is so simple, it was there all the time. It's called to your remembrance. This all comes from before, and so it is. That gives unction and documentation to Zadok, that is to say elect, that God's word is true. His promises are sure. If you believe, if you follow him, and so it is that he will teach. That's a promise. I don't know, have you ever been confused and wondered, well, I really wonder what that means. Have you ever asked him then? I mean, it's a promise from God. Have you ever read Isaiah chapter 43, verse 26? Do you know what it says? It's God speaking. And he says, remind me of my promises. Don't worry, he hadn't forgot them. He wants to know if you know. Remind me of my promises. Let's talk about it. God wants to talk to you about it. Then I can justify you. I mean, I can answer it. You see, you have to claim it. So when you're confused and if you're ever worried, ask him. It may not be instant, but it will be within days. You will have your answer. And sometimes he may give you an answer that you grab onto quickly and you'll go down the road a ways and say, whoa, this is rougher than a cob. But that means you didn't get it right, friend. Because it's never that rough, hardly, with God. However, unless you're a tough old bird, that he knows you're tempered and can take it. And that means he can trust you, and he knows you can handle anything that comes your way, as long as you're in his name, doing it his way, and abiding by his promises. Bring it on. Come on, Satan. Come on, bring it on. Because the Spirit of God will crush him in the name of Jesus. That's just the way it is. That's a true warrior of the living God who claims the promises, knows them, and obeys God. 27, what does he say then? Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. That's peace of mind. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You don't understand, brother, I worry a lot. That's trouble, friend. When you allow yourself to be troubled, that means don't worry is what it means in the Greek, okay? Well, if I didn't worry, it might not happen. Your worry has nothing to do with it. It's doubting the promise of God. So you don't have to be afraid. That's the beauty of Christianity, is knowing that you're under the wing of the living God. And if you truly believe, and God always takes care of his own to accomplish not your will, but the will of God. And from that comes the blessings. 28, ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If you loved me, you would rejoice because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. I'm at his right hand. The Holy Spirit is there. He is greater. And that means you're going to have even more power yet. Because he's on the throne. And he hears you. He knows you. Verse 29, and now I have told you before it came to pass, that when it has come to pass, you might believe. In other words, I'm going to be crucified. And on the 50th day, that's how it will end out, he didn't say it here, which is Pentecost in the Greek tongue, you're going to receive the Holy Spirit. You're going to have it. It's going to tell you what to say, what to do. It's going to guide you. So what you're concerned about is guide me so that you can be a better servant to the living God. Verse 30, hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh. That's Satan. That's the Antichrist. That's the dragon. And hath nothing in me. 31, but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so do I arise. Let us go hence. In other words, he promised that he would send that comforter. And what a comfort it is. Beloved, it's very difficult for you to receive the comforter and then worry. Okay. Do you understand the two don't go together? You can't have received a comforter and be worried about something. It's human instinct that you're careful about things. But you know what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. There is nothing going to happen to you that doesn't happen to everybody. And God knows he can test you, and he's never going to test you over what you can handle. That's why I can say, bring it on, Satan, okay? Why? Because with Christ in front of you, he can't touch you. He has no power. And therefore, we have that solid fix that with God through the Son, that we are his and he is ours. And he can utilize you to accomplish your plan, no, his. And if you truly love him, that's what you want to do. Accomplish not your plan, but his. If you want blessings, otherwise, have a good trip. Okay, as he said, he wouldn't have to talk to us much after that. Why? Because he sent us the letter. You know, I want to take you back into the Psalms. Go with me to Psalms 143. That's in the Old Testament. Psalm 143, beautiful psalm. I want to pick it up with verse 7. Psalms 143, verse 7. Old Testament. Hear me speedily, O Lord. My spirit faileth. I mean, we got troubled times. Hide not thy face from me, lest I be like unto them that go down into the pit. I don't want to go to hell. Cause me to hear thy loving kindness in the morning, for in thee do I trust. You do what? I trust. Cause me to know the way. That's the path. Guide me in it, that path, wherein I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. In other words, I give my soul to you. Why? It belongs to him anyway. Verse 9, deliver me, O Lord, from mine enemies. I flee unto thee to hide me. Do you know something? That's some of the best advice you will ever have. If you're too concerned, hide in Father, in his word, for he is the word. Hide in it. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Hide in it. It gives you knowledge and wisdom and protects you. Verse 10 is why we came here. Teach me, that's guide me, to do thy will, for thou art God, my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprighteousness. I want to tell you something about this word, teach. It's lemet in the Hebrew tongue. Do you know what it means? It means goad. Now, do you know what a goad is? A goad is a nail on the end of a stick that you goad livestock with, okay? It's a cowpuncher, the original, okay? And in the spiritual sense, he's asking God, goad me if I need it. This is why Paul would say on the road to Damascus, God would tell him, Paul, why do you kick against the pricks? Because it's the prick of the goat. I'm trying to teach you, and you keep trying to destroy the church. And you're hurting nobody but yourself kicking that nail. So what do I want you to gain from that? Is that if God is using you, sometimes if you don't quite get it, you can rest assured he's going to make sure you do. He's going to use the goad in love beginning, and more so as he leads, guides, and directs until finally you say, oh, I'll do it. Okay. You're going to get it. Okay. That's a form of spiritual communication. It's called tough love, if you want to. But it didn't just happen to be named lemet, the teaching, meaning a goad to teach with. It's strict, it's stern, it's true. It will not let you down. You don't obey God, don't expect blessings. You're not going to get it. You're out. But when you respect him and do things his way, honor his covenants and live them, you'll be blessed. Otherwise, you're cursed. Okay? And so it is. That's what that lemet is, that old goat. God has a way of reaching you. And verse 11, quicken me, O Lord, for thy name's sake, not for my sake. Guide me to your will, for thy righteousness' sake, bring my soul out of trouble. He always does, if you believe, if you know. There's been many of us in combat that if you talk about a real Christian, he knows how to make a real Christian out of you, okay? He knows how to bring you out of trouble that many people could not even stand. Verse 12. And of thy mercy, cut off mine enemies and destroy all them that afflict my soul, for I am thy servant. Are you? Are you his servant? If you obey those commands. In conclusion, one more chapter, 25 of this great book of Psalms. There is a lot to be learned in this 25th Psalm. It is an acrostic Psalm. And acrostically speaking, it has fantastic messages. It begins with double a leaf. If you have companion Bibles, you can see it in the margin as it is given the Hebrew letter, a leaf. It's doubled. When you get to verses 18 and 19, you'll see a double resh. That's a double R for 18 and 19, calling special attention to it. Verse 11 is singled out as center. And let's just ease into it and see if we can understand it. Verse 1. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. A leaf 1. A leaf 2. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not mine enemies triumph over me. In other words, this is a double lock that your trust and your faith is in him. Or really, if it isn't, you needn't go on. But it double locks it, a double a leaf. And then the betta comes in, verse 3. Yea, let none that wait on thee be ashamed. Let them be ashamed which transgress without cause. And you got a lot of that in the world today. Verse 4, show me thy ways, O Lord. Teach me thy paths. Goad me. That's what it means. That's what this word teach is. Lamed. Lead me in thy truth and teach me. There it is again. For thou art the God of my salvation. On thee do I wait all the day. I wait for the truth. Well, I just don't have much patience. Well, poor you. God has lots of patience. That's why he picked you. Okay. Verse 6. Remember, O Lord, thy tender mercies and thy loving kindness, for they have been ever of old. You've always been that way. You've always been tender. Remember not the sins of my youth, and nor my transgressions according to thy mercy. Remember thou me for thy goodness' sake. O Lord, for your sake alone, use me. Verse 8, God and upright is good and upright is the Lord. Therefore will he teach sinners in the way. That's what that old goad is for. That means to, if you have to teach a little bit on the tough love side, that's fine, no problem. Verse 9, the meek, that's the humble. Will he guide, there's our word again, in judgment. And the meek will he teach his way. He'll give that right path. Do you know when he guides you in judgment, what that means? Helps you make the right decision. Are you with me? Do you understand that's a promise from God? Have you reminded him of it when you have a tough decision to make? Remind him of it. Ask his guidance. Verse 10, all the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth unto such as keep his covenant and his testimonies. Now, there's a qualification there. You've got to keep the covenants, or I'm sorry, you're out. Verse 11, for thy name's sake, O Lord, pardon. We're in verse 11. This is what the center of the acrostic. Listen to it. For thy name's sake, O Lord, pardon or forgive mine iniquity, for it is great. Now, again, this is again that the letter lamed. Okay, and it's the first time repentance is brought forth in the Psalms. And repentance, meaning admitting guilt, admitting sin, bringing forgiveness. And so it is that even the repentance links that repentance to suffering in the next, verse 12. What man is he that feareth the Lord? Question. Him shall he teach in the way that he shall choose. That's a promise again. Verse 13, his soul shall dwell at ease. That's rest, peace of mind. And his seed shall inherit the earth. The offspring of God's elect, they inherit Almighty God, as it's written in Ezekiel 44. Verse 14, the secret or the counsel of the Lord is with them that fear him. That fear is to revere or love, as well as fear. And he will show them his covenant. He'll teach them his covenant. That's a promise. Well, I just have trouble understanding. Well, ask him. Don't be shy with your own father. The closest relative you've got is the living God. He created your soul. He cares. Ask him. Don't be shy. Verse 15, mine eyes are ever toward the Lord. I look there, and he shall pluck my feet out of the net of deception. He will touch my mind to where I will never fall in a trap of Satan's. He will always give me that way out. He promised it. I claim it. End of story. Okay. You'll always have that truth. Verse 16, turn thee unto me and have mercy upon me, for I am desolate and afflicted. There are times that you're going to be lonely. There's times you're going to be alone. But you've always got company. Why? It's his promise. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. He will comfort you. He promised to send that comforter. You can feel him. You can touch him. He can touch you with the truth, with guidance, and with direction. Verse 17, the troubles of my heart are enlarged. O bring thou me out of my distress. Lead me out. That means guide me out. It's a promise. He'll do it. Now, listen to me closely. Verse 18 and 19 is a double resh. Do you know what resh stands for in the Hebrew alphabet? It's head. Who is the head? I'm going to give you a little secret that maybe some won't understand, but I'm going to risk it. We had the double aleph to start with. I called it to your attention. Here we've got resh, and resh means head. In your mind, who is the head? It's God, of course, right? But do you know if you take a leaf, resh, a leaf, do you know what you just spelled? You spelled the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. How fantastic acrostics are if God gives you the gift to meditate upon them, to understand them, to see the hidden promises that God places there for those that are led of the Spirit, to be anointed. Now also, verse 18 and 19 is God speaking, looking, he's up, looking down upon you. Okay. Now understand that before we read 18 and 19. It's God speaking, looking down upon you, the double resh. Look upon mine affliction and my pain and forgive all my sins. Number one. Number two, 19. Consider mine enemies. Look them over good. For they are many and they hate me with cruel hatred. And do you know something? In these end times, every corner, every nook and cranny, there is some atheist or agnostic or someone else trying to destroy the name of God and the work of God. It won't do them any good. They're whistling in the dark, okay? Dark being Satan, of course, and so it is. They're not going to accomplish anything because nothing, nothing can hold back the word of God. You know, I think that this little church in Northwest Arkansas started out with 120 members. It's the largest independent church in the world today. We have more listeners. We have more stations. We have our own network that goes all the way around the world. Do you think we built it? No. God did. Nothing can prevent or stop the Word of God. It is powerful. It is complete. God looks down when you believe enough. He takes care of your enemies. You don't have to worry about it. Naturally, being careful and using common sense. But let God do the heavy lifting. Verse 20. Oh, keep my soul and deliver me. Let me not be ashamed, for I put my trust in thee. That's so important, beloved. You know, you're not going to be ashamed. Why? You know the truth. Do you know what the greatest shame in the world would be? In my opinion, is a Christian that really means well, and for them to actually worship that one that's coming claiming to be Jesus, and he's the false one. Because they've been taught they're going to fly away. And that's what Satan's message is, I'm going to fly you away. And that's the greatest shame in the world, is to have listened to men. You don't have to understand the book of Revelation, you're going to be gone, is what they say. When even the book of Revelation means to reveal or to uncover, you're supposed to know it. Then you won't be deceived. How precious it is to have eyes to see and ears to hear. Put your trust in God, in his word, in his testimony, in his deeds. Verse 21, let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait upon thee. Be patient. Study to show yourself approved, but wait on him. Redeem Israel, O God, out of all his troubles. That's to say the 10 tribes that went north, settled the Caucasus Mountains, were later called Caucasian, that settled Europe, later migrated to this great nation, and those 10 tribes are here today, that part of Israel, in Canada and America. Blessed of God, and God leading, how precious it is to be a servant of the living God. Heavenly Father, guide us, Father. We ask that, we claim that promise to have the Holy Spirit touch, guide and direct, Father, protect and bless. We ask it in Yahshua Jesus' precious name. Amen, amen.
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It is getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. There is no need for you to be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject, the Mark of the Beast. The telephone call is free. The CD is free. We don't even ask for the shipping and handling. It is free as well. All you need to do is call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also request your free CD by mailing your request to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Of his own, you betcha. There's nothing to prevent that. God loves all his children. He created every soul. Brian from Texas. Leviticus tells us we are not supposed to eat certain foods. This is in the Old Testament, and the New Testament says that foods are clean and it is okay to eat them. You're very wrong. Okay? Let's see what you say. Colossians 2, 16 and 17. That's concerning holy days. Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 through 5. We just taught that. What does it say in verse 3? It says, don't let anyone judge you in marriage, and don't let anyone judge you in food that God created to be received. Did you hear me? That God created to be received. He did not create scavengers to be received. They will make you sick, okay? And then in verse 5 down, he'll say, all animals are good. You bet. Scavengers keep disease off the earth. that like the swine has no sweat glands, so all the poison it eats all of its life ends up in the fat. And it will make you sick. Now, it's not a sin to hell for you to eat scavengers, but it is a sin to your health. And that's why he said it. Hebrews chapter 7:4 has nothing to do with food, so I don't know where you're going there. Hi from Illinois. If all races were created on the sixth day, what race did Adam and Eve produce? They were created on the eighth day, and they created the race through which Christ came. It's Eph Ha'adam, okay? And so it is. Martha from Arizona. Will we have the same parents in the third world age that we do now? You'll have one parent. You will know your parents, but we will only have one parent. It's our Father God. He will expect his children. There will be no birthing in that time, which we do not give or take in marriage because we are as the angels. Why? Because we are messengers. That's what an angel is, of God, children of God. And the reason for birth has served its purpose. It was where by each entity, soul from the first earth age could be born into this one innocent, not knowing about the overthrow from before. Being born innocent of woman, a babe, to make his or her mind up whether you're going to love God or Satan. It's always your choice. It's your way to go. That's what this earth age is about, okay? And in the final countdown, we have one parent all, and he is the creator of your very being. That is your real parent. Your closest relative is God himself. Read Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 4, where God puts his claim out, stakes it. All souls are mine. They're his children, and he loves them. Marion from Oklahoma, where in the Bible does it teach the first earth age? And please help me understand Genesis 1:1. Well, Genesis 1:1 is pretty clear. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, period. It didn't say when the beginning was, but it says God did create it. Verse 2 is what you're interested in. Verse 2, let me quote it from the Hebrew. Tuhu vavuhu, that is to say, the earth was not created void and without form. God doesn't create anything that's void. It became void and without form because of Satan's rebellion. Okay, God destroyed it. He could have killed a third of his children, but he far rather would destroy that earth age and bring in a new one and try to save the children. And so it is, he's in the business of saving. So your companion Bible, if you have one here from our library, it kind of explains that. And then as I quoted earlier, if you read Jeremiah chapter 4, along about verse 18, where God says, my children are a little bit sottish, it means stupid, okay? They don't know that once before they irritated me to the point that I tore this world up. I didn't let one town, one village, any animal survive. I wiped it out. And if you don't think I'll do it again, try me. And he does have, it's an interesting thing. And we'll be teaching that again probably before too long. Marlon from Arkansas. What covenants did God make with us? Well, there's the Abrahamic covenant. He renamed Abram to Abraham, whereby Abraham is the father of many nations. And that's why that Abraham is a blessing to all nations. Why? Because Christ would come through that family, through Israel, the Lord Jesus Christ, and through him would come salvation to all nations. That's ethnicity in every form. The children of God could find salvation from even Satan's overthrow for having worshiped him in the first earth age to standing against him in this one and earning the right to have eternal life in the third earth age. You can read of all three earth ages and heaven ages. We only have one heaven and one earth, but we have three different ages, eons of time. And you can read of them in 2 Peter chapter 3, all three of them. Mildred from Texas, if a person has dementia, does God take that into consideration? Of course he does. Anyone that is handicapped, God, our Father is a loving God. When you see what he puts up with, I just quoted 2 Peter chapter 3. Let me quote a verse from it. It says, God is long-suffering. I mean, he's got lots of patience. And it is his will or wish that all come to repentance, that they get their act together. They won't, but he's given them the opportunity, and it is his hope that they will. He's not going to force them. They got to do it on their own. And he hopes that all will come to repentance, and so it is. He's a loving father. And he doesn't wake up every morning and say, I wonder who I can zap today. He wakes up and he wonders how many that will accept him and be saved that day, and how he can bless someone, how he can help someone that is deserving of it. And so it is. Alicia from California, is there anywhere in the Bible that has a specific dinner prayer? Not really. You know, I don't like written prayers. And you know something? Our Father doesn't really care all that much about them. Maybe when Christ fed the multitude, he had an order. He divided them up in groups of 50. And he said, I want you to divide up and make them sit down in order. And then he gave thanks to our Father. It's from the heart. All you do is that dinner prayer is to say, ask him to bless the food you're about to partake of. I mean, we got a lot of pollutions in the world today. Ask him to bless it and purify it. And whatever you're doing that day, ask his blessings on that. Just talk to him. Prayer is simply talking to our Father. He hears you. And he would a lot rather have you speak to him from his heart rather than have you read something somebody else has written. That would be like if you were, Eloise, if you were courting somebody and you got a letter from them and they didn't even write it, they had somebody else write it for them, would that letter carry that much weight for you? No. The way when you knew it was in that person's handwriting that you loved, it was from them, and it was their heart speaking to you, then you appreciate it a lot more. Well, so it is with our Father. You don't need a written prayer. Talk to him. Just he's so understanding, and that's what prayer is. And always pray to him, but ask it in Jesus' name. That gives credentials that you're a Christian. Curtis from California. When the fallen angels come to earth, did they impregnate Adam's daughters or Noah's daughters? Well, Noah's family was the only family. He, his sons, and their wives that still had a perfect generation. You can read this in Genesis chapter 6. When you break that back to the prime, it means progeny. It means their generation and pedigree was pure. Pure Adamic. Adamic means ruddy complected. They had not intermixed with the fallen angels. It was the offspring of Adam's daughters that they impregnated, but Noah's family was pure. That's why he was saved. You know, many people don't understand, teaching against this is what caused one to be raptured, or God knew him and just took him. And you can find in the great book of Jude where he was taken, Enoch was taken because he preached against this. And he naturally wanted the daughters of Adam to stay with the Adamic family. But they mixed with the hybrids, and that brought about the flood of Noah's time. Alex from Arkansas, will a man go to hell for divorcing his wife or wives, no matter what the reason? Please document. Well, I'm not the judge, God is, okay? But if you're a Christian, you know that if you were the reason and the cause of these divorces, and you repented, would you be forgiven? Can you tell me in the Bible where it says that divorce is an unpardonable sin? I can answer it for you. You can't, because divorce is not the unpardonable sin. Adultery is not the unpardonable sin. They are sins forgivable. End of question and end of time. I'm out of time. Thank you all for studying God's word chapter by chapter and verse by verse. I love you for that, but most important, God loves you for it. Why? It's the letter he sent to you. And when you read it with understanding, it makes his day. When you make his day, boy, is he going to make yours. We're brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we have helped you, you help us keep coming to you. Once you do that, you bless God. He will always bless you. Most important, though, you listen to me. Listen good now. You stay in his word. Every day in his word is good, even with trouble. You know why? Because Jesus, Yeshua, he is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast audio tape, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a tape catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at this same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Deuteronomy. The law was given as our schoolmaster. Have you been to school on God's Word? Certainly one way to go there is to study the book of Deuteronomy. Probably the most exciting thing that Deuteronomy has to offer for you is that great song of Moses, that those that overcome the false Messiah in the end generation will be singing. The law itself being the schoolmaster that keeps us out of trouble in these flesh bodies. Again, an education in taming that part of you that oftentimes needs taming through the old schoolmaster, that great book, Deuteronomy, the law, and its set ways of keeping you from harm's way even in this generation. You're going to enjoy it.
Thank you.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Say, welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. The Ark of the Last Days, as it was in the beginning, so shall it be at the end. It is amazing in a spiritual way, the book of Genesis, in the prophecies given to the 12 patriarchs, and the flood, and then